Hello and welcome to Heresy, the show that challenges received wisdom and gatecrashes the party of lazy thinking. With me to publish lazy thinking's address on Facebook, raid the drinks cabinet and wee on the floor are Rufus Hound, Matt Johnson and Joe Brand. We'll be arguing against three statements of widely held belief. Later in the show, they'll be about women and the mentally ill, as if those were two different things. Welcome back. But first, perhaps the widest received opinion that has formed in Britain since we were last on air, 98% of our live audience here tonight believe the Brexit debate has divided the nation. Rufus Hound, we're not here to discuss the issue itself, rather whether it's divided the nation. Do you see nothing but division?
No. In this country, what we love is misery. Right? And I think, regardless of whatever side of the debate you're on, you can be cross about this. And we love moaning and whinging and blaming other people and hauling others over the coals. We adore it. No wonder it's going on and on and on. No one wants it to end.
Joe Brand, can you see any unity in Brexit?
I think we're united in the sense that we're so fragmented. I mean, I would like a customs union, a free curly-whirly every day, and some free dandelions for my tortoise. And I haven't met anyone else that's interested in that yet. The alternative of that, which I think we'd all enjoy because we love Downton Abbey so much, is that inexorably we're all united in returning to the Victorian era. Because it's not going to be very long before workhouses open up again. I'm looking forward to a bit of downstairs. Being a cook somewhere in a stately home.
I'm glad that's what you meant.
Yes, not that. Exactly.
It's all your faces. Yeah, also a bit of downstairs with Mr. Hudson, obviously.
We shouldn't forget, of course, the United Kingdom is itself a union of some remarkable and distinct nationalities, the English, the Scots, the Northern Irish, and, the other side of Birmingham. Oh. Matt Johnson, has the Brexit debate divided the nation?
I think it's united everybody, and I do have a point. The UK has created some of the best characters in politics that we could ever imagine ever having. You've got Jacob Rees-Mogg, who is like a Beano baddie, and he's the perfect baddie in any sort of comic book. Obviously, Jeremy Corbyn as well. He's just like a cartoon character. Boris Johnson, I can go on and on and on. So I think the entire nation, especially me, I'm united, and I think this is maybe the start of a new campaign to bring back spitting image.
There's a logical issue at the centre of this. We asked this audience, are we divided by Brexit? And 98% of them said yes. So if we're all agreed that we're divided, then we're united. I think there was a phase where we were very divided, and people talked about it's very hard to socialise because people think different things and they fight. But it's gone on so long, I think we've moved through into our happy place where everything's awful. And we can talk about that. I mean, are we divided in our view of Parliament?
No. Every human being you would ask about the politicians of our age would look you in the eye and tell you a more hapless, useless bunch of so-and-sos you would struggle to conjure from a salt circle with the right incantation. I mean, there's just...
Is Parliament coping with the negotiations to leave the EU? I asked a team of researchers and producers at the BBC to put together a short summary of Westminster's best thinking on Brexit over the last year. Say, Joe, we are absolutely united in feeling we are living through a terrible time from a parliamentary point of view.
Well, yes, I would say that, but I think that's because certain unpleasant characters are being thrown to the fore and they're very, very easy to hate. And I'm kind of thinking, why bother with a milkshake when you could get some battery acid. That's just me, and it's all right. I'm not going to do it. It's purely a fantasy. But I think milkshakes are pathetic. I honestly do. Sorry.
Did you find, Matt, that there was a phase when it was difficult to go out because the subject would come up and people would fight, but now you can just all go, hey, and roll your eyes at each other?
No, it was. I'm from Wales, if you haven't already guessed. But I've lived in London now for 9 years, so I was in that kind of echo chamber of everybody was in agreement. And going back to Wales with an open mind after the result of Brexit, looking at now why people voted in a certain way, the work that's been taken away, the industries that have been taken away from that area, all the people that they feel over the years have taken their jobs and their society and their purpose away, there's a bigger issue to look at than just picking on some weary old racists.
Speaking of weary old racists, let's go to the audience. Let's ask some people among the 98% who think Brexit divided the nation why they think that. John Flynn.
I just can't believe so many people believe in something with almost no evidence, unelected, or we're fed up with rules being sent over from Brussels. And you say, what rules don't you like? And they never can quite tell you.
But do you find that unbelievable? Horoscopes are published in, you know, newspapers day in, day out. What we can learn from just looking at the world around us is evidence really only comes about fourth on the list of things people look for when they hear anything. I once said to Charlie Brooker, why is this happening? And he said, because people would rather have a comforting lie than the horrifying truth.
John, I think the answer you gave doesn't show how Brexit's divided the nation. It's just why you personally disagree with the referendum result, but surely you would have disagreed with lots of other things that other people think. And for me, the fact that it's sort of a huge thing and it's a crisis whichever way, if you think leaving is a crisis, that's one way. If you think leaving is a liberation but it's not happening, that's another way. In a crisis, we're united. I think climate change unites us. I think war unites us.
Do you think climate change unites us?
Yeah, we're all terrified. Gillian Rayfield, where are you? What leads you to believe that Brexit has divided the nation?
Because I have family members that stop talking to each other.
Well, and you're right, then it has.
That is a double-edged sword, though, isn't it? Because me and my friends are quite pleased some of our relatives stop talking to each other.
It's opened up an opportunity for us to possibly look at what's actually wrong. This is why this show is brilliant. It's opened up a space for us to actually talk about ideas and sit in the middle in some sort of non-echo chambery world, where it's a safe space to have a conversation about ideas. And I think that's not happened for quite some time.
We've only... shut up!
You shut your face. Shut your face. I think that's an idea.
I think it's time we moved on.
Oh.
The truth is, Brexit is an incredibly complicated and nuanced political and economic process involving decades of European legislation, passing comment on which is something best left to those qualified to do so. At least that's what Gary Lineker said on Twitter. So, moving on, we're going to talk about women and their relationship with makeup.
I feel pretty, oh so pretty. I feel pretty and witty and gay, and I pity any girl who's in me today.
Makeup is part of a complex sociological code. If my lips are red, it suggests passion. If they're pink, it suggests fun. If they're blue, call an ambulance. If they're black, cancel the ambulance. 75% of our live audience believe that women want to wear makeup for special occasions, but men don't. Matt Johnson, do you like wearing makeup?
Yes. Only on Thursdays. I actually do enjoy it. I used to wear black nail varnish when I was in school, And growing up in Caerphilly, that was a bit strange, and I didn't really care. And eyeliner, when I was into all my, you know, rock bands and all that type of thing. So I am a big fan of expression through makeup, and I have no preference whether a man or a woman should wear. I think you can do whatever you want to do.
I think I should probably explain to listeners at home, if you don't know Matt, he's so handsome that when we first met, I literally laughed in his face. I thought it's ridiculous to look like.
It was
like
a nice sauna, wasn't it?
If you don't know, Google Matt Johnson presenter. Do it now. I can wait.
Just remembering when we first met and you very coolly looked me in the eye and shook my hand.
I think you're also gorgeous and you sometimes have quite baroque facial hair. Mm. Is that different from makeup? Do you think it's okay for men to experiment with the hair but not with the colours?
The only thing that stops men from wearing makeup is other men. I don't really look after my skin a great deal. I get rosacea on my cheeks because I don't moisturise and I drink a lot of beer. But what would I do about that? Nothing! Because if I moisturise, what sort of half-man have I become? So we don't. I dressed up as Cheryl Cole and did a dance on television. Yes, I won, thank you for asking. But they gave me a full smoky eye. Big extra lashes, huge smoky. I've never looked hotter in my life. And to this day, if that wasn't, like, if I could just leave the house and literally no human being that I encountered had a second thought in their mind about why I might be doing that, I would do it all the time.
I think feminism has quite a lot to say about this. In the old days of feminism, makeup was really frowned upon, and so we were all expected to look like Ken Dodd after he just got out of bed. And these days, there are more liberal views about it. So you've sort of got a continuum now, haven't you? You know, left-wing, radical, man-hating feminists who wear dungarees and shave their heads, all the way along to lipstick feminists who have sort of suits on and are loaded with every conceivable piece of makeup. Now, the problem with me is that I actually am one of the lipstick ones, but I look like one of the shaven-headed ones.
I saw the light on this when I saw an American woman comic. Unfortunately, I don't know her name, but she was talking about how before you record a panel show, all the men pop in and out of makeup for about 2 minutes, and then they go and think about what they're going to say and calm down and think about the performance. And the women are in makeup for about 45 minutes, being tweezled and tweaked and painted and coloured. You don't really get time. And I suddenly thought, of course, I have never questioned it. And I think the same is true at a party, on your wedding day, anything you might be nervous about. You spend all that time staring in the mirror, getting more and more nervous. And I've sort of done it because I think that's what you do.
But I also think, because of the gender imbalance on panel shows, the woman in the makeup room is so absolutely delighted to have someone to work on for more than 20 seconds. They virtually manacle you into your chair and they're going, you know, would you like me to cut your hair? No, a bloody wouldn't leave me alone. And with poor Merton, all they do is a slick of powder and that's it, he's gone. So
also, I think we've lost the joy in it. My daughter was at a party recently, she's 3, and they had face painters that do them up as cats and dinosaurs, and they're so happy and joyful. We never do that, do we? I've put on a bit of mascara and lipstick so that you think, even though it's a radio recording, I'm taking it seriously, which I am, and it's important. If I'd come fully done as a T-Rex, you would think I was weird.
We all sink towards the middle, don't we? So there is a sort of ongoing kind of regulatory process of what you're allowed to look like.
You know, teenagers, because of this whole sort of explosion of kind of online stuff, they are spending hours putting makeup on for a few shots on Instagram or Facebook or whatever it is. And I kind of find it really disturbing. And there are 13-year-old girls that look 35.
To look a certain way that they think society wants them to look like, or are they just doing it as a hobby? Is it just a new way of having fun after school?
Well, this is exactly my point. If it's as a hobby, that's great and it's joyful, but why does all the makeup have to be a big mouth, a smoky eye.
Yeah, if it's more of a hobby, I'd be a tiger or something. That'd be fun.
Right. Let's go to the audience. Hannah Bleeker, why do you think women generally want to wear makeup and men don't?
What do you mean by want? It's sort of a question of maybe women want to wear makeup because society tells them to wear makeup and men don't because society tells them not to. But I think maybe in a society where people don't really, or women don't wear makeup, maybe they wouldn't want to.
Do you wear much makeup yourself?
No, mostly only for special occasions.
What is a special occasion to you, Hannah? Because to me, it's a wedding or a funeral. And when I go to a funeral, I do like to look a bit like a dead person because I'm at a funeral. So I tend to go for very pale foundation. Or what counts as a special occasion? Or every weekend if you go out, for example?
I'm very inconsistent, so it really just depends.
Glad to hear
on
it.
How I'm feeling.
But you're saying the same thing as us, really. What do you mean by want? Yes. Perhaps we don't really want it. We're just trying to fit in.
I think there's definitely something to be said for, yeah, if you have a spot, just cover it up. It's a lot easier that way.
You see, I think it is absolutely not easier. You cover it up, and then you worry about, has the makeup rubbed off? And you put your finger to check if it's still there, and you rub it off, and then this the spot is there. And now people can see the spot, but also that you put makeup on, so you look vain and spotty.
Yeah, I mean, a part of the reason I don't wear makeup very frequently is because I like to touch my face, and I find that it just kind of rubs everywhere.
Just, brothers, take a moment to consider that sentence, will you? I quite like to touch my face. But, men, have you ever had to question whether or not you could touch your own face? And yet, every woman in this room, as that was being said, went, yeah, yeah, here. We are in those constraints. We live on parallel worlds. I have to wear a wig for my job at the moment, and I spend my entire life going, trying with my little finger just to move an invisible hair out of my eye. If I turn my head too quickly, then the wig sticks to the lipstick, and then I apparently look like a man who's walked through a cobweb. It's this gurning mess of a human being shambling through the world, and it's all because of long hair and makeup. You think, why would you do this? And the answer is because you have to.
You have to. Exactly so. I think we've won that argument. My final note is to make clear I'm not anti-makeup for men or women, as long as it's fun and easy and joyful and not just stressful. Some men have amazing makeup. For example, I remember watching Johnny Depp in Pirates of the Caribbean 4 on Stranger Tides and thinking, my God, this is a terrible film. Finally tonight, we're going to talk about mental health, with particular reference to obsessive-compulsive disorder. This is one of the most sensitive topics of our age, very, very easy to cause offence for obvious reasons. But luckily, my guests tonight include an ambassador for the mental health charity Mind and a former psychiatric nurse. So you know we're going to stay on the right side of taste.
Bananas in pyjamas, I'm coming down the stairs. Bananas in pyjamas, I'm coming down in pairs. Bananas in pyjamas, I'm chasing teddy bears. Costs on Tuesday's day, I'll try to catch the unawares.
Yes. That was a very silly joke, which I thought was funny, despite the fact that I don't think it's at all funny to actually be ill, and I personally suffer from a version of OCD. Or I hope it is, because 60% of our audience believe you should not use the term OCD wrongly or jokily. Jo Brand, was it okay to play that music?
Of course it was, yeah. I mean, interestingly, I went to an event probably about 7 or 8 years ago now, all about a group of young people with mental health problems reclaiming some of the words that have been used against them. And to open up the proceedings, they fired a cannon full of bananas all over Camberwell Green. It was marvellous. I think what we have to do is operate on an intent level, and that's actually very hard to assess. I don't feel offended if someone says I'm a bit OCD because I know what they mean.
When people say I'm a bit OCD and they don't really have that condition, I still hear a cry for help. I think we live in an age where people, they can't get off their screens, they're always contactable, there isn't any calm, there isn't any peace, and they're looking for a term that means I'm anxious. And even using that term wrongly, at least it's self-deprecating. It's a world away from how people used to use a term like spastic when I was a child, which was othering and accusing and horrible and nasty.
Yeah, but I was assuming you were meaning people using the term in, you know, I'm a bit OCD. Oh, sometimes I think I've left the oven on when I go on holiday.
It's such a vast and complex world that we live in when it comes to mental health. I live with depression, and I've been conditioned to say, you know, live instead of suffer with depression, but I suffer from it. At times I find it really, really difficult to get out of bed, and shouting people down I feel is very dangerous. We are shouting people down for saying the wrong thing without any intent of actually making that person understand the reality. And I think Stephen Fry said this, he said, we prefer to be right than to be effective.
Matt, you're an ambassador for Mind, and you also have a mental health-themed podcast. Mm-hmm. Is it very serious? Do you avoid making jokes?
No, I joke all the time about it. I've got a very dark humour about what I went through. Like I would always say, I got into a pickle 10 years ago. I tried to commit suicide or take my own life. You can't say commit suicide, is it? That, you know, all these things. So I always try and make light of it because I say it all the time, and it's important for me to own it by making fun of it slightly.
I think it's kind of all about intent and ignorance, really. And there used to be a lot of jokes on the circuit, like, roses are red, violets are blue, I'm a schizophrenic, so am I, you know. Which really just kind of demonstrated that people didn't have any idea what it meant,
yes, but
really.
That is the annoying thing about schizophrenia from a comic point of view. Yes, from a comic point of view. In order for any joke about schizophrenia ever to work, it always had to rely on the idea that schizophrenia involved multiple personalities or split personalities. It just doesn't. There's a joke that I like. My therapist says I have schizophrenia. Joke's on her. I don't even have a therapist. Now, that would be very funny if only schizophrenia were what people say it is. But I don't think telling that joke means you think it would be funny to suffer from schizophrenia, which is one of the worst illnesses that can befall a person.
It's really important to ask people, do you think this joke about the illness that you've got is funny? When I was a nurse, I used to have a laugh with people. It doesn't preclude you mucking about with people and having a laugh.
I want to talk about this topic on this show because it's a way of showing how much the world has changed since we last made a series of Heresy. Because of the echo chamber, because of the Twitter world, a strange thing has happened where these days, sometimes, the majority opinion is also the heresy. Most people would think it's fine to use terms like bananas and nuts and loony if you're making light-hearted jokes, and yet, if you made such a joke without questioning it, that's also a heresy. Were you frightened, Rufus, when I said we'll be talking about mental illness? Did you think, oh, no, I'm going to get in trouble even though I'm not a bad person, you shouldn't talk about these things?
I think the question you're asking, if I was a functional human being, I would say, yes, I did worry about that. But instead I thought, I'll be fine. The wider issue, it feels to me at the moment, is about jokes in general. And I think people associate... It was really interesting, you kept saying, you know, I make light of it. That often is what people think jokes are. Is making light of something. But actually, jokes are often how we Voldemort. It's actually about staring at the void, the horror of existing, and saying, do you know what I'm going to do in the face of that? I'm going to laugh. Yeah. The problem is that we don't have a mechanism that tells us where does the line get drawn, and all we have to go on really is intent. Jimmy Carr tells a joke in a comedy club on a Friday night at midnight to a bunch of very drunk people, and the Daily Mail write and reprint it. The same people who were at that gig and laughed could read the same joke on a Monday morning and find it awful.
I don't know. You see, we talk a lot about, and I'm really trying to push through and be heretical, because that's the idea of the show, and I don't know if you draw the line anywhere. So, for example, you mentioned about your family. A terrible thing in my family is my great-uncle died in a concentration camp. He fell off a watchtower. Now, he didn't. He died in a concentration camp. having been taken away from his home with his children. They all died there. Do I need to say that in order to retrospectively justify my joke? What if he hadn't died in a concentration camp? I think we can hear jokes and go, oh, that was a bit off colour, or that was unwise but meant well. But I don't think you draw the line anywhere.
Offence is never given, it's always taken. It's not your responsibility where the offence is, if you're a comedian or whatever. It's a really murky, murky area. So I'm a firm believer in, like, everybody has the right to say whatever they want to say, and we have the right to tell them they're idiots.
Weirdly, going back to the first question, don't you feel a little bit like the Brexit thing comes out of jokes? Oh, the French. The Irish are stupid and the Scottish are tight. It penetrates our culture and it penetrates our subconscious. The Brexit thing, fundamentally, there is a Richard the Lionheart Britishness, you know, that version that we have of ourselves, that is, do you know something? Europe can do one. We're better off without them. And it is slightly fed by a culture of the Germans have got no sense of humour, the French smell, the Swiss are rubbish.
That's our dream.
Really about the Swiss, is it? Doing all right.
We have to wind this up. Unfortunately, we don't have time to go to the audience on this topic because we've run out of time. It's a complicated topic, and I know we don't all think the same thing, but certainly I feel and hope we're in a much better place talking about mental health than we were 10 years ago or 20 years ago, and it's not going to be perfect. People are going to use terms they don't understand and get them wrong and make jokes that aren't quite right, but it's part of moving towards a raised awareness. And before we go, I just want to say that I truly believe that if you encounter a fellow human being who's in distress, who's obviously hurting deep down, then simply telling them a joke or even pulling a funny face is the best way to get fired as a paramedic. I hope none of this gets me fired from Radio 4, because honestly, genuinely, all I care about on this topic or any other is that people are just kind to each other. I think that's the only thing that matters.
It's the only thing that matters! It all just comes down to don't be arseholes to each other.
It's a better slogan than bollocks to Brexit.
Yeah. If only there'd been some magical figure 2,000 years ago who'd said something similar and we could write it down in a book, then maybe 2,000 years would have been long enough for us to come to terms with the fundamental truth of that.
Well, I genuinely hope I haven't given any offence. I think it might be a slightly risky time to make this series, which was originally set up to test the boundaries of what it's OK to say and not say. Good luck us in 2019. We'll be back next week. Or will we? Thanks for listening.